pleasure to be here with you, distinguished visitors, with our incredible Hong Kong Productivity Council leaders and leaders in the community. I'm really honored to be here with you, and I think I represent a different perspective than you have heard this morning. I'm very happy that Professor Gan, Professor Sui, and Dr. Fong all mentioned people, because I believe that technology is wonderful. We are going to be able to develop fabulous technology, but you know what? It's only going to work in our behalf. It's only going to enhance our lives if there are people involved, if people accept the technology, and if the technology enhances the human experience. And in order to get there, we have to have new talent pipelines coming in, not only to develop the technology, not only to sell the technology, to install it, to maintain it, but to use it as well. And so I'd like to talk to you about those talent pipelines, because I think they are critical for smart futures. Let me give you a little background on the context that I come from in Silicon Valley, where innovation is expected, and at Stanford University, where excellence is a threshold. MediaX is an industry-facing program of the Human Sciences Advanced Technology Research Institute, and what we do is to build bridges across the disciplinary activities at Stanford, but also build bridges between the academics and the university folks in order to identify big ideas, take a small concept of those, and test it as quickly as we can, learn from that test, and use that to develop new ideas. We call that rapid iteration, and it's part of the prototyping mantra, I guess I would say, that is infusing much of the global innovation these days. Essentially, we're a membership program, delighted to have Hong Kong Productivity Council as a member in our program, and we engage in discovery collaborations. Our members are global. We have groups in Brazil, elsewhere in China, in Europe, United States, who are thinking about some of the same things that we're talking about today, about people and technology, and about talent pipelines. In order to move quickly in an agile world, it's imperative. MediaX taps the many labs of Stanford University in which researchers are interested in questions and methods that keep both people and information technology as a part of the equation. There are labs that do just the technology. They're very fine labs. There are labs that study just the people. They're doing wonderful research. We work with the labs in which both people and technology are considered. So that's the context out of which I come. And what I want to share with you today are several key points about the time that we're in, which I do believe is a perfect storm for change and transformation. The human dimension of smart cities and smart futures, which I think is crucial. And then a few thoughts about how shared vision and trust can accelerate innovation. Sound good? You up for it? All right. So let me take you out to sea. We're in a little boat looking at the horizon. We might be able to see 3.5 miles to the horizon. That's our view of the future. If we were economists and looking at cognitive cycles, we might be looking at 50-year cycles as we think about the future. Any of you in the pharmaceutical industry are probably looking at 11 to 14-year cycles in the way that innovation happens. Any of you who are working in blockchain or social media are probably working on 11 seconds as a cycle for innovation. But the perspective that we take on innovation and how long we have to adapt to the speed and the change depends on the kind of environment that we're in. And we are in now what many people would call perfect storm, in which we have forces coming from many different directions and converging on on where we are at this point in time. Now in California, we have many people who love to surf. Your oceans here, your bay is beautiful. I haven't seen much surf, but for the people who do surf, you know that there are several things that are important. One is that as you're on the board, you keep your knees bent. You have to have your knees bent so that when those waves start to rock you, you can ride the waves. Another is you're going to put your arms out for some balance. But a third and a critical element is not only are you going to look at what's in front of you, to look at the wave you're on, you are continually going to be looking over your shoulder at the wave that's coming from behind. And this is an important element for those of us in innovation. Because in the environment we have today, change is happening from every direction. It may happen from the least expected corner of your perspective. So keeping your knees bent, your arms out, and looking behind you at all times is very important. Clearly, we have disruption to prepare for. And in doing all of these things, you're looking for patterns. What's happening and what can we make of these patterns? So I know it's after lunch, but I think you're up to this challenge. I'm showing you four numbers and I'm going to ask you what number comes next. Who knows what it is? Righto, it's a smart group, I knew it. All right, let's try it again. What's the number that goes in this box? Oh, come on. No, it's difficult, I grant you. But there was an innovation that happened quite a long time ago, before the electric engine, that changed the way that we think about numbers and the way that we manipulate them. And that innovation, the zero, was an innovation at one point in time, has changed the world forever and is actually a fundamental component of the digital age that we are in now. So in this digital age, data is the new gold. But I want to say that talent is the new gold also for living, for mobility, and for working. Talent is local, yes it is. Talent is global. And you know that with the click of a button, as long as you can get on a network, you can be in touch with people around the world. In California, for example, from Hong Kong, and you can be working together on projects. And we have been, through MediaX and at Stanford University, we've been studying new ways that this can happen, that the talent doesn't have to be just local. That you can draw from global talent and mobilize it in new ways in order to set up what we call flash teams. Teams that would come together for a special purpose, might be mobilized into an organization, complete tasks, and then disband and be ready for new tasks. It's as if we can have pop-up employers. You know the concept of pop-up stores. You see them in retail environments, shopping centers, where on the corner, all of a sudden, a facility will be erected. People open a store. It lasts for maybe a week. They sell the market. They test the market. They close it up, and they go, we can do this with talent now. Pop-up employers. Build a team. Do the work. Say goodbye. And one of the things that this means, and the millennials are very good at this, they have a mindset for it, is that they begin to think of their careers not as jobs and organizations, but as a series of projects through which they build their talents, they demonstrate their talents, and they can trade on the basis of their talents. So human dimension of smart is absolutely critical. Combining human intelligence with automated intelligence, I believe, is one of the challenges that we have for the next century. The data systems that we have involve are essentially identity systems, and we need to be able to make smart decisions with the data that we have. We need to do smart reskilling, and we need to have smart system leadership. I'm going to talk about each of those a little bit. From the algorithms and the service infrastructures to the computing infrastructure, the energy that it uses, the technology infrastructure and support, the users, their networks, and what they do with the information is part of the whole system that makes smart buildings, smart cities, smart environments. We focus on developing the technology that might be able to, over a series of cameras in a hallway, track a particular individual and understand that where that individual is going, perhaps even interpret their next action. Or to be able to use technology that will allow us to perhaps see inside buildings from the outside. And in all of these, the data that is flowing from one system to another is flowing through APIs that are connected through databases and legacy systems, mobile apps, infrastructure. So it's very much an ecosystem of entities and applications through which data flows. The way that we name that data, the ontologies, will have a lot to do with how that data can play together across different systems as they become part of services. And the way that we make decisions with those is going to also engage the human and the automated systems together. So if we want to have a smart future, we need to think about how technology enhances the human experience, enhances the human experience, and leverage technology for that. Smart cities are going to be identity systems. They are identity systems for people through the use of applications and services on smartphones, in offices, mobile systems. But they are also identity systems for things, as objects begin to carry identification. And in the automation and the artificial intelligence together, we can see the intertwining of humans as both meaning makers and as sense makers, with identity systems that are, have both personal identity and the identity of things, and the intertwining of sense making and making sense. It's really quite complex. And we must understand it. We must understand how it will help to enhance the human experience. Some of the frontiers that we're looking at have to do with the way that both verbal and nonverbal dialogues with automated agents will take place. And we saw some examples of automated robots and conversations with those, the perception of human emotion, whether that would be coming from a conversational robot or if it would be coming from your car or your home. As homes and office environments become smart, we will have what we consider to be dialogues with them, conversations that trade information, exchange information about our state, the state that we're, our intentions, and how we can optimize those. And as we are learning about how to construct these dialogues with automated agents, we are learning a very important thing, that people are wired for people. And so personality becomes very important. Whether it's the personality of your automobile or if it's the personality of a medical robot that comes with a particular prescription to encourage patient compliance, that the personality matching of automated systems and people is as important as the information that they are sharing. You know, we are always learning about ourselves as people in interaction with each other. Being able to apply those insights to the construction of interactions and conversations with automated systems is one of our next frontiers. And so when I talk about smart, I'm talking about the overlap of sense making and making sense. That's smart. So when a system is communicating information, it is perceived in the way that it is intended to be, and it is received and acted on in the way that is anticipated and expected. That's smart, because it involves both sense-making and making sense. Okay, it's a tall challenge. We're going to do it. In order to do it, we must have talent that is up to the task. And we know definitely that workforce and learning pathways are shifting. We see in many places, in many sectors and around the world, that older workers are falling out of the workplace because they don't have the skills that are needed for them to stay in the workplace. And we hear the cry in many corners of the world that the science, technology, engineering, and math interests of youth are less than we would like them to be, that the pipeline of new workers coming in is not sufficient. And so to think about this, I'd like to share with you some axioms and some perspectives from several of the people at Stanford University with whom I work. One is Roy P., and he makes the point very ably that technology is not simply an amplifier. It reorganizes the activity systems in which learning, conversation, work, and representational practices are achieved. And Martin Carnoy, who talks about an increasingly close relationship between physical and human capital. An increasingly close relationship between physical and human capital. And a major complementary investment is required for the human capital systems that we want to modernize the 21st century. The choice of the physical capital and the technologies in these solutions and the way that they are installed, operated, maintained, require a major investment in the human capital that can use them. Now, I'll show you a couple of images, and you know these axioms. Number one is, of course, Euclid's axiom that the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. And the second is that any line segment can be extended indefinitely between two points. And the third, that given a point and a line, you can draw a circle centered on the point with the line as its radius, right? These are axioms we all have learned. There are some new axioms that relate to training and the development of talent that are very important. And the first is that the more general the knowledge, the less likely private firms are going to pay for transferring the knowledge to their employees, and vice versa. The more specific it is, the more likely private organizations, companies are willing to pay to have that transferred. The second is that the more abstract and general the knowledge to be transferred, the more the training requires face-to-face interaction and powerful teaching, such as business decision-making for executives. So the more abstract and general, the more face-to-face, the more mentoring, the more hand-holding is necessary to transfer that training. And third, the more specific the knowledge to be transferred, the more the expertise can be taught in direct contact with the technology. So put this bolt here, turn this way, adjust this lever this way. And those type of tasks can be virtualized for virtual training. Now let's take this to the skill-based learning that many people around the world are saying is greatly in need. We are not turning our backs on higher education. We're not turning our backs on research and universities, but we are saying we need much more vocational training, skill-based training for the futures that we want to create tomorrow. And there are several axioms that I will share from Martin Carnoy on this. And that is that in the context of most market economies, vocational education that is preparing workers in secondary schools for specific jobs has not been very successful unless that vocation and the training is for a job that's in high demand at the time that the students graduate. It makes sense, doesn't it? So our educational programs have to be in time with the jobs that are available to the students as they are graduating. As I say this, you're probably saying, yeah, Martha, that's right. But it isn't that way in many areas. And we are working in California on a number of experiments to try to bring the kind of training and vocational education in line with the skills that are needed on the jobs that are available now. Second, that the specific job preparation is most successful when it takes place in firms already employed workers on equipment that the workers will actually use. So they're actually using the tools that they will be using. And in training institutions such as HKBC Training Institute, that they're linked to groups of firms and train workers that are employed in those firms taking place. So this is, you know, high five for HKBC on understanding this and already doing it. The third general axiom for vocational education I'll mention is that training for tasks using new technology requires access of trainers and trainees to the new technology. If they're going to be trained on the technology, you've got to have the technology for them to be trained on. And it usually goes best when those workers are trained in the firms already possessing the technologies and have trainers with it. So what does this mean? It means that there has got to be a collaboration between businesses, between innovators, between businesses that are using the technology, and between and with the training and the training institutes. So who do we need to train? Somebody's going to design the 21st century Hong Kong. Do you think it's important for them to have a sense of system leadership, for them to understand the partnership between human and automated intelligence, for them to understand that identity systems concern both people and things? Yeah. Where are they going to get that? That's outside of any department that currently exists. Hong Kong already has many engineers and computer scientists and urban planners to help design the future. The question is whether enough of them are able and familiar to move into the cutting edge technologies. We're going to need technicians who can install and repair, maintain and operate the systems. And these are going to require, these will probably be some Hong Kong native technologies, but they may be technologies that come from elsewhere. And the first generation of technicians should probably be trained by the suppliers of those technologies. Something important to keep in mind for global collaboration. We're going to need executives to make decisions and preparing executives to move into the next generation of technologies and beyond. Deciding the strategies, the subsystems of knowledge to bring together and bringing that all together. So what do these people need? How many of you have children or grandchildren who are in high school now? Yeah, higher, okay. And how about in college now? Are you worried about whether they're going to have the know-how, the perspectives that they need for the future? Some of the things that they will need and the opportunities that we have in training programs and among educators and among the community of people who will support training and education are the personalized learning at scale that is available. We have a lot of people learning from YouTube. That's cool. It goes around the world. We have a lot of people learning from MOOCs, massively open online courses. That's cool. Coursera, edX, and a lot of different platforms. And we have the capability of learning how to teach, learning how people learn in those environments, because learning pathways are being massively transformed. We need to understand how to map the dependency relationships in learning. We need new methods of metadata tagging, new recommendation engines. We need digital assistant and feedback systems built into these networked learning opportunities, and understanding the identity and relationships, how they are influenced. Another big opportunity we have is multimodal learning. It's an opportunity for technology and people to come together. Showing here a media room where many different types of learning, some tactile, some visual, some sensory, acoustic, some conversational, all come together. And another example in which students are virtually immersed in an environment. And the beauty of this is that what the eyes see, the brain perceives as an experience. So many virtual experiences can be used. The important aspect of learning and leaders and talent that we need are people who have system leadership. Eleanor Ostrom, a Nobel-winning economist, talks about the commons. The commons refers to an asset, a resource that belongs to all of us and influences all of us. We might think of this planet Earth as a commons that we're on, for Hong Kong and Shenzhen and Guangdong, the Bay may be a common asset. System leadership is critical. And as we move in the press to productivity and we establish metrics for that productivity, those metrics, I would argue, I would plead with you, those metrics must include quality of life, sustainability, and inclusion. So this is a group out of which the leadership will come. And the importance of shared vision, of networks of trust, can't be overemphasized. We have, for a long time, thought of organizations looking like this. The way that things get done is often more like this, based on relationships through which talent, resources, and information flows. And change and transformation happen because people share a vision. And although they may independently act on their particular sphere of that vision, with a shared vision, they have the opportunity to end up together in the future. And so thinking about the new coalitions that form out of the shared vision that develops in meetings like this, in the programs that HKPC offers, is really a critical resource for transformations into the future. As you, as leaders, are mobilizing those transformations, keep this in mind, that people are wired for story. And what one person says is not necessarily what goes into the other person's brain. That as I'm talking to you, I am speaking from my context. You're hearing my words, and you are assembling those, disassembling and reassembling those words into the context that you brought with you. And so you may take away a meaning that is very different, a little bit different from the intention that I have had in sharing ideas with you. One of the tools that as communicators and as leaders that we have to increase the perception, increase the effectiveness of the messages that we want to share is telling stories. And if you can tell a story about the future that helps the person that you're talking with, see themselves with you in the future, you are very likely to be able to communicate a future that you both end up in together. People want to participate. They want to be part of the future. They're saying, if they could all say, put me in the story. Put me in your story. Let's have our story be a story together. So thank you very much.